On Monday the 9th of January 2017, Polaris shocked the motorcycling world by announcing it would be shutting its doors on Victory Motorcycles. Since the first production model rolled off the line at Spirit Lake, Iowa on the 4th of July 1998, to the Octane, its final model released in 2016, Victory has come up with some great motorcycles. You're watching Dazzle Rebel Rides, and this is a list of all-time top 10 Victory motorcycles. Number 10, the Victory Crossroads. In 2010, Victory announced the Crossroads. With the claim of most power and cargo capacity in its class, the traditional bagger style predated Polaris's purchase of Indian motorcycles and aimed to tap into the heritage market. Powered by the 106 cubic inch Freedom engine and able to take a massive 21 gallons of cargo, it was as practical as it was punchy. Ultimately phased out with the launch of Indian, the Crossroads remains a great motorcycle to buy on the used market. Number 9, the Victory Gunner. Launched in 2014, it would be 2015 before we saw the Gunner on UK soil. Ultimately overshadowed by the launch of the Indian Scout, the Gunner was nevertheless an incredible package. The stripped back bobber looks were right on trend, and the chunky 130 section front tyre mated with a slim 150 section rear made it handle surprisingly well. Number 8, Cross Country and Cross Country Tour. Introduced in 2010 in an attempt to take a bigger slice of the burgeoning bagger scene, the Cross Country was an instant hit in its native United States of America. Sales were slower in the UK as British riders struggled to understand how such a large barge could possibly handle itself on tight, pothole-ridden roads. Yet handle it did, and those that dismissed it missed out. The tour version added side fairing panels and a trunk, boosting cargo capacity to a world-leading 41.1 gallons. That's bigger than most small hatchbacks. Number 7, the Judge. Introduced in 2012 with the tagline "American Muscle Never Died," it just needed handlebars. It failed to capture the imagination of riders in its native cruiser market. The same couldn't be said across the pond, as European riders lapped up the muscle car-inspired styling. The mid-mounted foot pegs, beefy suspension, and aggressive stance were something that us Europeans appreciated. Sales numbers confirm this as fact, as the Judge was culled from the 2015 lineup stateside, but continued to 2017 and Victory's eventual demise in Europe. Still a great bike, and still a great buy, especially with a Stage 1 exhaust. Number 6, the Victory Vision. Journalists thought a spaceship had landed when Victory announced the Vision back in 2007. With sci-fi looks and the new 106 cubic inch Freedom engine, it didn't take long for the luxury tourer to gain hardcore fans and even earned a Motorcycle of the Year award in 2008. Boosted by a special NES custom version, it plugged a gap that nobody knew existed in the touring market, as it sat somewhere between a Harley-Davidson Road Glide and a Honda Goldwing, yet managed to outdo both with its sheer ballsy styling. Vision owners tend to be fanatical about their bikes, and it looks set to become a future classic. Number 5, the Victory Highball. If you were looking for a bar hopper in 2012, then you could do a lot worse than the Victory Highball. Daring to put ape hangers on a production bike was a ballsy move, but it paid off in spades. The position of the high bars might look extreme, but even short arses like me found it surprisingly comfortable to ride. The different matte colour finishes work well with the bike. From the double black and custom flame specials, to the nuclear orange paint of the final 2017 edition, the classiest, and arguably the best, is the two-tone white over black with the white wall tyres. Perfection. Number 4, the Victory Hammer. Named Cruiser of the Year when it was launched in 2005, the Hammer introduced the world to the power cruiser concept. You might argue that Harley-Davidson got there first with the V-Rod, or that Yamaha did it way back in the 80s with the V-Max. But it was the Victory Hammer that gave this class its name. With a massive 250 section rear tyre, the Hammer was a staple in the Victory lineup for 12 years. The Hammer 8 Ball was a perfect blank canvas for carving out an aggressive custom machine, while the Hammer S and NES versions were ready-made canyon carving beasts. Number 3, the Victory Magnum. In 2014, Victory took the successful cross-country, slammed the rear, and stuck a 21-inch wheel on the front. The result was a Magnum, a blinged-up bagger with, bags of attitude, and dripping in chrome and sumptuous metal flake. Although arguably a little more challenging to ride at slower speeds in the cross-country, the Magnum eats up the twisties when you get motoring. You could be forgiven for thinking that this bike was all about style over substance, but you'd be so wrong. This was the closest you could get to a custom bagger while sacrificing very little in practicality and retaining maximum performance and handling. You can't be shy when you ride a Magnum, and with the 200 watt 6 speaker option, it's a party on two wheels. Number 2, the Victory Octane. This one might shock you. Yes, the Octane received an incredibly lukewarm reception from the press, who were expecting a much more exciting machine. Victory really scored a home goal here, as the whole marketing campaign revolved around the Project 156 Pikes Peak competition bike. What we actually got was, in effect, an Indian scout in Victory clothing, as my first ride video said at the time.
Click the link here if you want to watch that now.
Yet that's not strictly true. The engine and chassis were originally destined to become the Victory Octane before the Indian Scout was conceived. So in essence, the Scout is actually an Octane in Indian clothing. That's what makes the lackluster press response so intriguing. As I said in my first ride video, for me, the Octane is actually more of a rider's bike. The bike makes you feel happier to squeeze the most out of the liquid cooled V-Twins Red Line, with its more agile handling at speed and greater lean angle. So why is the Octane at number 2? Well, for me, it is a combination of the fact that it both spawned the Indian Scout while actually being a better bike to get your speed fix from. It's the most engaging road-going Victory to come out of the Spirit Lake facility and fully deserves the number 2 slot on my list. Before we look at my number 1 Victory motorcycle of all time, let's take a quick look at some other great production bikes Victory have made over the years. The Victory V92C. This is where the Victory story started, and many would argue that it more than deserves a place in my top 10. However, what those people have overlooked is it was still essentially a prototype. Victory was still finding the way on power two wheels, and the V92C was a testbed for what was to come. The styling was off, and the build quality not what we'd come to expect from the Spirit Lake team. The Victory Hardball. Combining the practicality of the crossroads with the meanness of the highball, it was just too far a stretch for some people and never sold in the numbers that Victory may have hoped. The Victory Impulse. When Victory bought Brammo, nobody would have thought that they'd end up with a podium finish at the toughest road race in the world, the Isle of Man Tourist Trophy. With Victory halting production, only time will tell if the Impulse electric platform will re-emerge as the world's first electric Indian motorcycle. The Victory Boardwalk. Essentially a cruiser version of the Crossroads, the Boardwalk was an attempt to enter the heritage market. It was a good bike, but ultimately made redundant once Polaris bought Indian. The Victory Kingpin. Somewhat of an oddity, the Kingpin played a similar role to the Boardwalk. It was a slightly more classic looking custom bike to everything else Victory was producing at the time, but it never shined anywhere near as brightly as my number one Victory bike of all time.
Number one Victory motorcycle of all time. It is the Victory Vegas.
The Vegas is the bike that really launched Victory into the mainstream. It set up the design cues that would be a staple for all future Victory motorcycles and provided the company with its own identity, away from being seen as yet another Harley clone. The Vegas 8 Ball was my first introduction to Victory motorcycles in the UK. I was shocked by the huge grunt from the then 100 cubic inch V-twin, coupled with a well-balanced, easily handling chassis. After riding Jack Cruisers and Harleys, this was a welcome surprise. I test rode a Vegas Jackpot with a Freedom 106 250 section rear and a swept Stage 1 kit a short while later, and fell in love all over again. These were essentially mass-produced custom bikes that dripped with style and oozed with confidence. The Vegas is a motorcycle like no other from its era. The closest thing Harley-Davidson can muster was the Breakout, and that came 10 years after the first Vegas and cost nearly twice as much as the entry-level 8-ball. For me, the Victory Vegas is the greatest bike they ever produced and will forever hold a special place in my heart. So that's my list. Do you agree with it, or would you change the order? Let me know in the comments, and if you enjoyed this video, give it a like. I will return to weekly regular motor vlogging in the spring, so remember, if you like the vibe, be sure to subscribe. Take care.